A federal high court judge, Justice Abdul Dogo, has been abducted by gunmen. What is happening to security in our country? Rehabilitation centers or torture houses, whichever one it is, the Nigerian Civil Security and Defense Corps has discovered two more in Kaduna State. This is Plus Politics, and I am Felicity Ezewuike. It seems that no one is safe in Nigeria anymore. As a federal high court judge in Ondo State, Justice Abdul Dogo has been abducted by gunmen who are now demanding a 50 million naira ransom for his release. Justice Dogo is not the first government personality who has been kidnapped over the last month. Some others include Musa Rabo, the Assistant Commissioner of Police in Suleja, Niger State, and Danlami, Yunana, a Taraba state government official. What can we do to stop this bout of kidnapping? Joining us to discuss this are two political analysts. I'll start with Dami Adebayo. Thank you very much. And of course, we have Alesta Wilcox joining us. Thank you very much, gentlemen.
It's always my pleasure. Thank you for having me.
All right. Another kidnap. 50 million naira ransom. What are your thoughts?
I think if we start to understand and acknowledge the fact that the security situation in our country is a mix of so many different things, from, you know, the fact that we have a low ratio of policemen to citizens, to the fact that, you know, the economic situation is terrible, to the fact that we haven't invested in the technology that we should have invested in a long time as a country as well. Considering the fact that a lot of these kidnappings happen on the road as well, and considering the fact that, you know, this is a high court judge, these are people that are meant to be not more protected than the average citizen, but at least, you know, there's a sense of security consciousness that goes around with having people in these offices as well. It's a shame, and it's something that unfortunately we've seen happen too many times as well. For me, my first solution as well would be to start with restructuring the police force as well. It's just not fit for this century or to police that the people that we currently have as well. I saw recently that the Nigerian police force was going to be having a conference here in Lagos as well, on the 28th to 30th, with senior police officers as well. And I saw it and I was thinking that, you know, the priority of recruiting and training more policemen hasn't happened as well. The fact that, you know, states like Lagos depend on the federal government to supply policemen, which shouldn't happen as well.
So many issues. We'll try as much as we can to cover all of it during this conversation. But let's just go on a quick break. And when we come back, the conversation is just getting started. Don't go away. Very happy to know you're still with us. My guests are still here in the studio. And before we went on that break, we're talking about the ransom situation. Now, previous guest on this show, when we talked about kidnapping, has said it's now a business. Do you expect them to pay up?
Well, let me just say it. The issues are multifaceted. You will discover now that you're not hearing case of armed robbery any longer. Because armed robbery is no longer lucrative. And it takes a lot. I think the last major armed robbery case we had is the one of robbery incidents. So why go for the hard target when you can go for the soft target and get higher returns? Because really and truly, due to our poor security situation, police may ratio to citizen, the landmass area of the country, deforestation situation in the country, it makes it creates a lot of security issues, and so you find this thing. But and of course, people always want to pay up because nobody wants his loved one to be killed or manhandled, because these kidnappers, they have no human feelings, because I mean, when they go out to do such, just like armed robbers, they know there are only two options: succeed or be killed. And so they have already sold their hearts to the devil, and they don't have. So it would be a protracted. Yes, that's what negotiations are on, because they will put their price so high, and they begin to negotiate, it will be a protracted, like there was an SSS, former SS operative that was kidnapped along the Lokoja Abuja route, Okene Lokoja route sometime. And when it was, he said, please, if you can pay, pay. Because these people are sophisticated.
Okay.
They are not just that day-to-day miscreants.
Yeah, but does it worry you that it's no longer maybe some businessman, or last week it was a police commissioner?
No, because you see,
this week it is
a judge
of a court in Nigeria.
Let me say this. There are two sets of kidnappers identified. One, the random kidnapper.
Mm-hmm.
So they don't know who is. They want to strike. You are there at the wrong time when they strike. And then the targeted ones are the ones that will go to your house. They have already planned you, monitor your movements, just like the type Evans was doing. Evans was not doing random kidnapping. Evans was doing targeted kidnapping. So they have targeted you, watched your movement, trailed you to the point where they will pick you up. But the most of the ones you have, like even the ones that the police officer, they say he was not a target. Remember when Ozokume was kidnapped in 2013, they told him, well, you're not a target, we'll just have to operate. And unfortunately, you are the one that was there. When those five pastors were kidnapped coming to Lagos, according to them, they said they were told, we don't know you anywhere. But how to operate?
So it's basically a business, a survival.
You see, because there will always be criminals in any society. And the criminals will always tilt towards where the risk is lower. They also calculate risk. Like all these people now that are doing kidnapping, maybe they were into robberies before. And robbery is no more. I mean, they've discovered that. I see, when this whole thing started, some of us shouted. And I always say it without fear of perilous critics. I always say it. This whole thing started in the South, and then graduated to the Southeast, that expanded it. And now that it has become profitable. Not that the security forces have not been doing anything. They've been busting so many gangs.
Okay, let's look at it this way. This happened last week. You would expect I'm just trying to jump up from what you said, that it's not that the security agencies are not doing anything.
Yes.
But it's been almost over a week that commissioner of police was abducted.
Yes.
There's been no update other than a confirmation that he has been abducted. Again, this same situation, the police are acknowledging that he has been abducted. Now, the Ondo State Police, while acknowledging that he has been abducted, are saying that it is not their jurisdiction, that it is the jurisdiction of Edo State, because where this thing happened was closer to Edo State than Ondo State. Do you expect to see a speedy action on this in the shortest possible time? And why was that, what was it needed to clear up, jurisdiction in a case that involved human life?
I think if we start by understanding one thing, is that there are two Nigerians. There's the Nigeria for the rest of us, and there's the Nigeria for people that are high profile as well. And let's hope that he falls into the other brackets. And if he does, then there's this team in Abuja as well. It's the Nigerian Police Force as well. It's called the IGT, the Intelligence Gathering Team, and it's led by Abakiari, who busted Evans as well. And apparently these are the creme de la creme of the anti-kidnapping force of the police. And these are the people that would most likely be deployed to get them, and apparently they have a high, success rate as well. But it still doesn't belie the underlying points, which is the fact that the country just isn't safe as well. That, there is no definition by which we're going to say that, we live in a safe country. So if he is rescued, that's good. And, if he is, obviously, that's bad. But the underlying problem is the fact that, we don't feel safe. Not enough resources have been devoted to security as well. And I mean, for crying out loud, we're waging a war in the Northeast as well. So we're battling on so many fronts as well. So I think the load from the federal government, maybe it's time to start, if states have the resources to take up policing and security, then let them, by all means, as well. The Lagos State Security Trust Fund earns more than, the federal government allocation to security, if you exclude, the other parastatals, if you calculate just the police as well, then, the STF is the largest spender in Lagos already. So I think it's time for us to, take a lot of power away from Abuja, because if we know one thing, it hasn't worked for the majority of us. And, you know, slowly and surely start looking at, you know, local solutions, community policing as well, using a lot more technology for these things as well. It's incredible to know that one of the biggest kidnapping hotspots in this country is the Abuja-Kaduna. It's an express road as well. So to think about, you know, how we can't police an express road, and now we have the trains that are getting shot at, this train that is meant to be an alternative for a lot of people that can't take the road, that's getting shot at by random bandits as well. So it's something that we just need to take a step back and look and say, look, is this police for faithful purpose? If it isn't, then let's start it over again. Because it's not just the fact that they're not doing their jobs. In fact, they've become antagonistic to the citizens that they're meant to protect as well. So I see a policeman and I don't feel safe. I don't want to approach him. I don't even want to complain to the guy as well.
Exactly.
Because I'm scared that this guy is going to say, oh, are you a G-boy? And I know that's calm. Chairman, you know, that, you know, there's no way that, you know, investigations are run like that any other place.
Okay, so we would have been, one of the measures to stop this is an advocation for stiffer penalty. There are those who are even saying that one way to check it is to get a death sentence and then capital punishment, so to speak. But these people you said earlier are, I mean, they know that it's succeed or die in the process.
Exactly.
Will that be an adequate deterrent?
No, it will not. It will. I mean, a lot of states have imposed capital punishment. Ondo state has capital punishment for kidnapping. Ondo state has capital punishment for kidnapping. A lot of states have imposed capital punishment. Because, look, these people, they are already at the brink of make or break. So, what else? And again, the level of prosecution is too slow, too sluggish, and not publicized. Evans was arrested over 2 years ago. So what has happened to Evans' case? A case that Evans himself pleaded guilty, that the case are all clear, that there should be, like, been like 2 weeks expeditious trial, and this whole thing is sorted out. Evans is still in detention till now. So who will get who will get scared? Someone who is hardened. Get scared. The case will be there. He will just, you know, that the case, because by the time you keep, and then, like you said, our police structure is terrible. Our police structure is terrible. Our environment encourages insecurity. I tell you something. I just traveled to Accra just a few days ago through the road from Benin Republic, from Cotonou, from Benin Republic for Cotonou, from the border, that's the Benin Republic side. See, you get to Accra. Let me say, in Nigerian distance, let's something from here, from Lagos here to Benin, or say Warri. Now, you will not see a forest on the other side of the road. That's an expressway. You will not see a, okay, call it coastal road, because just like our Lagos, Lagos, Sagam is also like a coastal road. You will not see a forest. You will not see a town or a farm. In that environment, in such an environment, even if you are driving at 12 midnight, you feel safe. Not in Nigeria, you are driving to Ibadan. It's just now that with the new construction, they are not climbing part of the road. You find thick shrubs left, right. You are driving on. You are driving
is that enough reason?
No. It's part of it. Look, it's part of the incentive, because there is a possible escape route, a possible place to hide, a possible, most of the people that are kidnapped, they put them in houses. No, they put them in thick forests, move them around places to places. They don't have, most of these kidnapped gangs, like I said, those emergency ones that just swoop on people on the road, they don't have, most of them don't have bases.
Let me pick from something again that you said. Evans' case is 2 years running, and we don't seem to What Dumi is also a latest one that we have.
Yes.
That, you know, we still have not heard an update on it. These men apparently have become very successful from the crime that they perpetrate. Before now, we hear that the reason some of them engage in this is hunger, poverty, unemployment.
I don't agree.
That excuse, is it still valid in the light of the caliber of people and the sophistication of the process, as we've seen in the case of Wadumi and Evans?
That is where I disagree with you, the press. You know, I will always come hard on the press. You, the press, and people who banter unsustainable reasons to serious issues.
Everybody how do you mean? Government. How do you mean?
Now, you just said it. People say, because they are hungry.
You cannot blame the press for something that you've had questions. These people have been paraded on the by the police, and the police have said that some of them.
What I'm saying in essence is that if you have some comments, I was into a program. I want to mention the station.
Mm-hmm.
They are talking about this insecurity. In fact, they were talking about this judge.
Mm-hmm.
And if you see the whole anchor, because of neglect, because of poverty, Nigeria is the poverty capital of the world. That's why people are taking to crime, blah blah blah, and all those trash.
But that person is entitled to that person's opinion.
We are emboldening the criminals.
No.
Most of our reportage in this country emboldens because we paint the country in so we paint the security agencies.
It doesn't connect with what you just said and the question that I just asked. Because what I'm saying, I'm asking you is, these people have. I mean, if it is poverty, that has been removed.
It's not poverty.
If it is unemployment, apparently have finances now.
Yes.
So what my question is, not look at who is blaming who or who is hyping what.
There are criminals. And a criminal will be a criminal. Because even for kidnapping to be done, you need weapon.
Let's get Dami to share his thoughts. Dami, let's hear your thoughts.
Hello.
Yeah.
No, I think mainly for me, I think I'm in the middle on this, and you know, I'm literally in the middle as well. I think it's possible for you to acknowledge both things as well. To acknowledge that, look, that there is a certain level of desperation and poverty in the land that will push people to do things that are ordinarily unacceptable. But at the same time as well, there are people that go into this for the financial rewards as well, not necessarily because they were pushed to or they're trying to survive as well. And for me, when it comes to kidnapping, it's the fact that, you know, like you said, the barriers to entry are low. If I can do it and I know I can get away with it, then I will do it and I will get away with it as well. And then capital punishment as a deterrent as well, really, it's non-existent. We haven't seen it work. It probably doesn't work as well. And but irony, what I thought was really interesting was when you spoke about the fact that, you know, people do this because they want to earn money as well. But you also need to consider that there's a whole other group of people. People that are just observers of this, not the victims, but they're also victims in a way. So there are places in the north when people are kidnapped and they're taken to this small villages. And, you know, this is one of those kidnappings that they would kidnap you and they would take you to the ATM and make you withdraw your money. And you're literally in a village. I get the security reports and I read them and they're very interesting as well. And you're in a village as well. And you go to the village ATM and you withdraw. You're with the kidnappers, and the kidnappers are like, oh, and they're bantering with the local people. They're like, oh, hey, yeah, we've got another one. He's going to withdraw his cash, and they're just going to pull him out. This happens as well. And people in that town are not going to rise up against the kidnappers as well, because they're probably the biggest spenders as well. Obviously, this is less sophisticated than what we're dealing with here, but this happens on, you could see this happening on a small scale, so we shouldn't be surprised that this has happened on such a scale.
So that means, if we're looking at it from that, you just said something now that's, I mean, eye-opening. People in small communities where these kidnappers operate know them,
of course.
They're not speaking up. So when the police, like in the case that we have now currently, say that people should help them with information
that's true.
To get these kidnappers, we are not helping them, so why are we complaining?
Sorry.
Yeah, but because we shouldn't be the de facto, you know, investigators as well. I mean,
the community, like you were saying, is harboring these people, know them, encourage them, interact with them, so why are we complaining?
I'm sorry, where is the police going to come when there's reprisal for me speaking up against these people as well? Because I know I'm barely safe as well. These people are here, they're with cash, they're on my side at least for now. So why am I going to speak out as well? Because I know when I see the policeman, he's really not on my side. We have soldiers that go to villages and massacre people as well. Zaki Bayan wasn't that far ago. Odi wasn't that far ago as well. So again, there's not a lot of collegiality or familiarity that people feel when they see, you know, our uniformed people as well. So again, I think asking them to help now seems very, you know, self-righteous as well.
Will we ever be able to break that?
I think it depends on the police, really. Because look, the police must know that I think the police need to realize the fact that they are under scrutiny. And because for that, they must reinvent themselves. Like you said, you see a policeman, are you feeling pity for him? Are you feeling angry? Are you feeling this?
Right.
I don't know.
Yeah.
Because look, comparison is good. You can't see a policeman outside this country. His courage alone will give you confidence. His courage. Maybe a recruit, the way he carries himself, the way he appears, will give you confident approach him. But you meet a policeman in Nigeria, It's either the man feels frustrated, he opens his tummy big, he's wearing his bathroom slippers, he's just shouting on you, oh, go open your boot. What, you know? And what is the connect? So the police should know, and I've always said it. I've said it here before, and I've said it a couple of times, they need to reinvent themselves, because what is happening to the country today is a total failure of the policing system. I agree that there are a lot of other factors, economic, criminality. Like I said, those who are doing armed robbery, are they all poor? No, we used to have rich robbers. Wadome made so much fortune, built church, built mosque, sponsored Paul on pilgrimage. Nobody knew what he was doing. Maybe some people might know. Evans, I mean, has mansion, family. Does his wife doesn't know that he doesn't have a legitimate business or his children?
It's possible.
But most people will not talk, because how do you even speak? Now, if you go and give policeman information, you are not even sure he's going to act on it.
Mm-hmm.
Number one, you have to, this job, self, leave him alone. I beg, find a way, save yourself.
How can we address this deficit?
Let the police reinvent themselves. They have a good image maker in Frank Mba. Let the police reinvent themselves and make themselves. Look.
You mean reinvent? What exactly?
I mean, become a new breed police officer, 21st century police officer.
Mm-hmm.
We used to have a good police that in the 70s and 80s, where you feel confident going to a policeman. You see a policeman passing, you are straight. You feel safe, you feel confident, because the man respects himself, he carries himself in the highest of possible esteem and all whatnot. But that has totally, like Obasi just said, when armed robbers, thieves, we are all recruited to the police, what do you expect? There are bad eggs, too many bad eggs. It is not a bad case. They can reinvent themselves. They can become a more friendly police officer. They can become a cleaner policeman. They can become a more appealing policeman and taking their job serious to know that, look, if there is a crime in my environment, it is an assessment of my capability and my performance. That is just the only way to go. And again, talking about giving information, I think people should not, I want to say people should not despair in giving quality information if you have.
To the police.
Because that is the only way. Because if today you say it doesn't concern you, we don't know
who the victim will be tomorrow. Your final thoughts, Dami, on this?
I think you know, we've done quite a lot of police bashing, most of it justified as well. But again, they operate in a system where they're not adequately funded, they're not trained. So I think we also need to consider the fact that, you know, I mean, the police isn't independent. They don't generate revenue by themselves. They're essentially allocated money from the federal budget as well. And I think that is where we should be paying attention to as well. We should be looking towards politicians as well. I think the legislature just passed a bill, the Police Trust Fund bill as well, which looks good as well. And we know that, you know, the devil's always in the details when it comes to this thing. So implementation is going to be the next thing to watch out for as well.
Yeah.
But I think putting pressure on, you know, those that we actually elect to these positions and that do influence the fortunes of the police to a great deal is probably the way to go as well.
All right. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for your thoughts so far.
Thank you so much. My pleasure.
Cheers.
We will go on a short break, and when we return, we'll be talking torture centers in the north. That is what we'll be talking about. Stay with us.